Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all for the CP study circle on demonetization related amendments in income tax and the recent changes in penalty provisions. To handle this session, we have an eminent speaker, our friend and guide, none other than Mr. G S Prashanth. I request Siddesh Gatti to escort the speaker and the judge. And welcome to floor, okay? I also thank the speaker for his time and efforts imparting knowledge to the members. I thank on behalf of Bangalore branch of ICA. May I request Siddesh Gatti to present a memento to the speaker as a token of appreciation and respect. Prashanth G S is a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, practicing in Bangalore, a commerce graduate. He is practicing in the field of direct taxes and is mainly involved in search and survey matters, corporate taxation, international taxation, direct tax planning and handling litigation and representation matters at various levels. Before setting up his independent practice, he was working as a manager, taxation in Mr. Singhvi and SDU, a chartered accountant firm. He has presented number of papers on direct taxes in various seminars, conferences and other professional platforms. He has served as a member of the study group on direct taxes, domestic transfer pricing constituted by the research committee of Southern India Regional Council of ICA. He is currently co-opted member of the committee of international taxation constituted by the SIRC of ICA. He is also a faculty at Bangalore branch of SIRC of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He is one of the founder member of the Bangalore ITIT Bar Association and is presently serving as its joint secretary. With this brief introduction, I welcome you, sir. Over to you.
Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. At the outset, I would like to thank the Bangalore branch for having given this opportunity to share my views on the amendments related to demonetization and the penalty provisions. Before we begin, we are indebted to our parents for life, but we are indebted to our guru for the way we live. I take this opportunity to place on record my deep sense of gratitude and respect to my mentor C.A.S. Venkatramani, who has been a guiding force and factor in my endeavor of profession. Also, my respects to C.A.D. Devraj and C.A.A. Shankar, who mentored me at various stages of my professional career. He has enabled me to address his office gallery. To set the tone down, the topics of the day is demonetization related amendments and subsequently the changes in be the task of mine. There are certain dates I tell you, kindly we will discuss the relevance of it. Of the year 1857, what does it signify? Correct. 15th August 1947. See, it may seem like a second standard question, but there's a reason why I am bringing this up. Independence. Good. 25th June 1975. 75. Second date of emergency probably now since it's already said it's 21st March 1977 when it was lifted. So these dates go down in history. I'm sure there's one more day probably which needs to be part of the history. Not sure whether in golden letters or in red letters or probably any other thing which probably is outside the purview of the four walls where it's being recorded. So that date, the draconian date is 8/11/2016. So, on one hand you are saying literacy rate probably in India is 50%, 60% and Kerala has got 100%. But on one world of demonetization, probably the entire country is literate. right from a fruit vendor, street vendor, to a sweeper on the road, to the CEO of a company, to the minister, educated or otherwise, everybody knows what is demonetization and what is the impact. We are here to discuss only a fraction of what is demonetization, because dealing with income tax amendments. But that's a smaller picture what we are looking at. But the broader one is, what led to this particular thing which is known as demonetization, the legality or otherwise of it. See, there may be divergent views supporting a particular move, the legality of it and the constitutional validity of it. One aspect, probably comes further down in demonetization, the stoppage of probably the limits for withdrawal from the bank accounts. To the best of my knowledge, the Banking Regulation Act of 1949, there are many seniors who have done bank audits here, to the best of my knowledge, does not permit the banker to withhold customers' own money unless otherwise there is an order of the government or whatever, and the dues to the exchequer or the crown needs to be paid. Otherwise, the agreement is between the banker and the customer, wherein the banker owes us money because I have kept my money with the bank in a fiduciary capacity, is more like a custodian of my funds. Now there is a cap on the withdrawal. Is it legal? Is it legal is the first question. Is it legal? There is a wife who said no. It is not legal. Sir, why do you think it is not legal? No, why is it not legal? The fact remains they have not allowed it to be used. But why is it not legal?
This announcement should come from the RBI. Or
okay.
I mean, it should come from the central bank on the withdrawal of the currency rather than from the PM.
No. To correct you, gentlemen, the notification has come from the RBI, which says that banks will restrict these amounts. So to that extent, the procedure has been followed. Take a step backwards. There is an article 300A of the Constitution, which talks about right to property. Earlier, before the amendment to the Constitution many years ago, it was a fundamental right. Then after the constitutional amendment which took place, it has been taken out from the fundamental rights and it's made a constitutional right, which means that right can be suspended only by operation of law. There must be a law of the land which stipulates that your constitutional right may be taken away. For example, you have a property which you have inherited or bought. Can the government take away the property overnight saying, I think that you have amassed this property illegally, I think there is no rationale or reasoning or satisfaction, I think this is an illegal property, I am confiscating it. Is it permissible? But if there is a law which is enacted which permits the government to compulsorily acquire personal properties for public good, and when the government takes over the properties or acquires those properties, it is, though it is hitting on your fundamental or constitutional right to property, since it's through an operation of law, it is valid to the extent that government compensates you and takes it. Here, definitely your money is your property. There is an undue restriction placed on withdrawal. Maybe the hyper technical argument is, why do you require more cash? My reverse question would be, who are you to decide? If I am earning say 25 lakhs per month as salary and I withdraw and salary amount is obviously after TDS. Why I am taking the salary example is for a specific reason. After TDS, the due taxes have been collected by the government. The gentleman withdraws the money, burns it. It is his money, taxpayer money. The government cannot say, don't burn it, deposit in a temple, or don't give it to a temple, give it to a poor man, or donate it to the government, give it to the political party. The government cannot mandate it. If it is government property, if I am confiscating, or if I am selling off, or if I am burning, you have every right to question. So on one hand, it is my property, my money, which there is an undue restriction being placed. I am not a constitutional law expert, but to the reasonable reading of the provisions of the constitution, there is nothing that which prevents me to tell that somewhere the constitutional right or the law of the land has not been followed. This is one aspect of it. Income tax amendments probably are not too many, but the far-reaching consequences and retrospective amendments will look into it. But how did this scheme in Visaji, in many of the regular income tax thing, when we discuss penalty also, we will discuss the importance of a satisfaction note. Why an officer must be satisfied for levying penalty? Why must there be an officer being satisfied for recording of reasons under 148 of that? Why must the Director General of Investigation be sure and record a satisfaction before authorizing a search? Which means there is some element of personal belief that a particular action or activity to take place or has taken place which is not proper, which has to be made good. Therefore, the authorizing officer records a satisfaction saying yes. The DG will record a satisfaction saying yes. Mr. Rajgopal has amassed so much of wealth, there is information to his belief, and therefore he will send a team of officers from the investigation wing to go and probe the assets. But if the DG does not record the satisfaction, and if he has got a personal gross, saying, oh, in standard 12 when me and Rajgopal were sitting together, that we were playing cricket and I lost a cricket match to him, I owe that grudge against him, he cannot blame him. There is a law of the land which needs to be followed. Similarly, when we are talking about demonetization, who is the authority? The Central Bank, the Reserve Bank of India, established under the RBI Act 1934. What did they do? Under 26(2) of the RBI Act, the particular denomination notes of 500 and 1000, they said, ceases to be legal tender. Fine. Which means there is a decision taken which is impacting about 86% of the currency in circulation, translates roughly as per government estimates up to 15.4 lakh crores. The numbers may vary day to day, by the minute it might have varied, nobody knows. As per the latest available numbers in multiple newspapers, because the thing is now that if 10 people are talking something which is not true, and if it's being repeated, one gentleman actually famously said, it becomes truth. So, we are bound to believe that 15.4 lakh crores was the high denomination notes which have been so far, which were rather demonetized, saying it is not legal tender. Right? Some people wanted the constitutional validity, etc. etc. Cases are pending. They also applied an RTI for what? The satisfaction note and the minutes of the meeting wherein the RBI convened the meeting to find out what is the effect of that, which board of directors have their views, because RBI according to me should have 4 directors on their board, but presently the strength is at 14, so there are 10 directors sharp, and the quorum for the meeting should have been 12, it was 13, the quorum was maintained, but the details of which directors attended the meeting, what were the views, who dissented, who was in favor, who was not in favor, that information has been refused to the general public by citing something called as national interest. There is no reason to say it is national interest because, with due respect to whoever pointed out that reply for that RTI application, you are talking about a decision impacting the entire gamut of the country. What more do you require than national interest? It's not impacted a individual or a political party or one set of businessmen so that the others will gain up. No. This is something like the search warrant. You can't disclose certain details because it's a privileged information. They can't leak what their sources of information. It's not a case here. The public at large is affected because of the scheme which has not been made public. Which leads to a situation wherein, coming back to income tax parlance, when we say that if the officer has not recorded the satisfaction, the assessment proceedings are bad in law. Similarly, if the so-called minutes of the meetings have not been convened properly and not recorded, Assuming you say this scheme is bad law, can you go back? No. Which means it is a, in account AS 22 terms, permanent difference. Otherwise I will not, I mean difference, permanent difference. So in AS 22 terms, so you can relate any of these schemes with the government, one of our known terminologies. It's a permanent difference which will remain. Though the scheme is termed, assuming that somebody would, the Supreme Court would say the scheme was rather constitutional, nothing can be done about it because it is a event which is gotten over, the money has come in. Now, the latest report suggests that the quantum of money which came back to the system is not known. The amount of money that has been remonetized is not known. And the level of preparedness for the scheme is now, if 10 out of 10 people, if assuming 11 people according to the ruling party say that 11 out of 10 people, I'm getting a bit conscious, 11 out of 10 people according to the ruling party are supporting the move. So which is what they want people to believe, that each and every person, not only in India, abroad, wherever they are, even those blessings of people who have passed away are supporting this move. Because there was this God sent moment that you had to do this. Otherwise the country would have been in shambles. Now, the industrial output has gone down after 3 months. The garment workers are queuing up outside the factories for work. People are standing in the queues and economic loss is happening in terms of people not working. The employees from company take full 30 days salary but spend 2 hours. Being accommodated much more in the initial 50 days really, than to stand in the bank ATM queue to withdraw money. The economic loss of it is not being estimated. The industrial output loss is not being estimated. The job loss is not being estimated. But it is a fantastic move for the future. Why I am telling you this is, when emergency was imposed in 1975, I was not born, but I have heard stories. So which is what we have read and understood and observed. For the first 6 months, people supported the move. In this case, it was 50 days because it is a scheme of go digital. You all know when cyclone hit Tamil Nadu, how digital payments work. Everybody could use credit card, all payments were fine, electricity was up and running, internet was working. Is it true? Go digital. So, it is not as easy as it has been touted to be. If you look at the interview of Mr. Y.B. Reddy, who was a former RBI governor, he is also in the same position as what one gentleman today is holding. Here he says, look, if the intent was only to surprise and shock people, this is the method. Nothing else. Because ultimately, any demonetization, you want to surprise the people, fine, but there has to be a level at which you plan what needs to be done. And telling this background because everything is a knee-jerk reaction. On day one, the limit of exchange of notes was 4,000 per person. It was not per day, it was not per bank, it was not per branch, whatever. So one gentleman with the ability to stand in the queue for multiple hours could have gone to 5 or 6 or 7 banks on the same day and exchanged 4 into whatever. By the second or third day they realized this is not working. They said per bank, per branch, some sort of a rule came in. Now we are unable to comprehend because apparently some 115 amendments and to the rules and notifications have come. So it's probably only a superhuman effort somebody has to make to remember the amendment because it came by the hour, not even by the day. Now if you say the Supreme Court case law came in so and so year, wrote a phone, subsequently a budget amendment over to reasonably have time frame to think, okay, the Vodafone judgment which came, there was some time, the law was amended. Now nothing like it. Morning 10 o'clock, they get to know that somebody is exchanging more than 4,000. 10:05 you will get a press release stating that it is stopped with effect from day before yesterday. So, it's not even from 10:10 a.m. onwards. It's retrospective effect. Then the concept of usage of ink, which means if there was 10% or 15% of black money in the market, assuming it is 20% also, because nobody knows the real figures, I think 20% is a good number because again we have learned in our CA curriculum something called parity analysis. 18-20. So here also we will go by that ratio. 80% is white, 20% is. So to catch hold of 20% of, not even people, 20% of black money. Because the world global estimate says 6-8% is the black money. But we have certain people who are known in the modern day parlance as bucks who say it's more 20%, 30%, 50%. So therefore, to satisfy each one's ego, let's put it across saying more than 20% was black. How is the government able to justify inconveniencing 80% of the people to catch hold of 20%? And believe me, my personal opinion is that this can't be equated to soldiers standing in the border and guarding. You standing in a queue to withdraw your 500 rupees cannot be equated to a soldier who's living for his motherland. He is doing it for the country, not for the government. Governments may come, governments may go, it may change. But the soldiers are doing it for the country, it's not for the ruling party. No soldier in his own says, I go allegiance to ruling party or opposition or somebody who has never come to power. It's only the motherland which they want to serve. So there's no need of equating you and I, because we can never reach the level of sacrifice. Because we want our early morning tea made in our own house with gas, microwave if possible, then you'll have some nuts, you'll have fruits, you'll have fruit juice, then you'll have TV to watch, you'll have a newspaper to read. If it's hot, you will probably have a AC, if it's cold, you'll have a heater, then travel in air conditioned car, get parking. This you are trying to equate, you standing in a queue for 1 hour, to somebody who's probably without food, water for 24, 48 hours. Not only should he be away, he should guard the border. So such an equation, according to me, was not at all warranted. And I'm making this statement consciously that this is not criticism of any party or supporting anything, but scheme as such. Because when we look into how the amendments have come into the Act, you realize as to the grave nature of planning that should have been actually there. Otherwise, they are wanting to say that the second taxation law, second amendment bill. I think we need to switch off the light here probably for people to see it. Are you able to see it? They are saying it is accrued or earned not only before 26th November 2016 but also before it. Look into the taxation laws amendment as a, why did it come as a money bill? Why did this come only as a money bill? Had it gone to the Rajya Sabha, it would not have seen the light of the day. Now, being a money bill, it's only a procedure that it has to be sent to the Rajya Sabha. They don't have a right to amend it or reject it. After 14 days, automatically it comes back to the Lok Sabha and it will be passed subject to the approval by the brute majority, I would put it across as. Because of brute majority in one house and the lack of any majority in the other, this comes as a money bill. Be that as it may, fine. There is a constitutional validity for it. There is a history of money bills being introduced. So, we can't question this particular. I will come to the amendments which have taken place here. 115 DBE, 271 AAC, 271 AAC, and introduction of Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So first you have a Swachh Bharat thing, wherein everybody had a photo of, cleaned up, everything. But how many of us know that Swachh Bharat scheme was known in the earlier government parlance as Nirmal Bharat Kalyan or something? So it's something like I Prashanth G S, formerly known as something. Now popularly known as Prashanth GS, I have probably earlier known as some other name. So now the name which has stuck on or which is probably being more popularized is being touted as the greatest scheme. We have a minister for river, I think, to clean up river Ganga. Nobody knows the amount of waste that is actually getting into Ganga and the scheme for cleaning up. But you can't question them, because the very act of we questioning something which is touted to be a good intention makes us anti-national, point number one. Point number two, all of us are supposed to pack our bags and go to Pakistan. Point number three, we are not fighting in the border, so we have no right to talk. So with these three fundamental assumptions, we need to proceed with the amendments. We can't proceed to the amendments without having these fundamental assumptions. Because if you disagree with me, I can't go ahead. Because this is the fundamental structure, saying that whatever is coming is for the good and only good. Only good things are going to happen in the future. Whether you get your salaries or not, it will be a good time. Achhe din. But it is supposed to come. Please wait. If it means standing in an 8-hour queue to exchange your own hard-earned money, better wait for at least 8 years. Then realize maybe you should have done better. But with these fundamental assumptions that whatever has been proposed or whatever has been amended is in the best interest of all of us, including the soldiers, politicians, their binamis, etc., etc. I mean, the politicians, one important thing is you amend 115 BBE, you amend 271 AA, you want to levy 30%, 60%, 80%. Yeah, levy 125% tax. There was a scheme time in 70s when I think the peak rate of tax was 97% for people. So it's rationalized. They're going back. Good. Because always, how do you earn money now? Which income is exempt even till date? Agricultural income. So if you continue to do what your grandfather's father did, you will continue to be rich. So that is the one more fundamental rule which you need to follow. Therefore, you've gone back, brought up the tax rate side. On one hand, you want to reduce corporate tax burden, you want to give rationalized tax measures, but you have now 115 BBE. How many of you are agreeing with me that it's a retrospective amendment? It says with effect from 1/4/2017. We probably, as we go through, we will see that. Look at the object and reasons. Concerns have been raised that some of the existing provisions of the Act could possibly be used for concealing black money. It is therefore important that the government amends the Act to plug this loophole as early as possible so as to prevent misuse of provisions. Which means, here itself there is a contradiction. The presumption is, you have black money, you are concealing it. So there is a section which you could probably use to conceal your black money. If I want to conceal something, why would I want to take section 115 BBE? It will never come to light. If somebody honestly wanted to pay 30% tax, because the rate before the amendment was only 30%, if somebody wanted to take advantage of this section, he would have paid 30%, which was the maximum marginal rate. So where is the question of somebody concealing their black money by resorting to 115 BBE? There is no chance, because if they are paying 30%, when every other gentleman on the rate of tax is 30%, somebody need not have misused 115 BBE. It is something like, probably in cricketing terms, to say that you need not touch the ball to wait till the 20th over. He is definitely going to be out in the second or third over. So therefore, you need not tell people that you're misusing 115 BBE. It was never intended to be misused. It was a section which was there to bring to tax under 30% without giving you any deductions or set off against your income which you were declaring under 68, 69, etc. Now, it has been substituted by the Taxation Law Second Amendment with effect from 1/4/2017, which means for any assessment year beginning on or after 1/4/2017, the amended 115 BBE will be in force. What does it say? Well, income referred in 68-69A and reflected in the, this was the original thing which they amended to 60%. We also look at the amendment to the, what is with effect from 1/4/2017? Well, total income includes income in 68-69A, B, C, D, etc. and reflected in the return of income at 139, or income determined by the assessing officer, which in any case was an existing provision. Your tax may at 60%. Finance Act 2016 was amended to include a penalty of, sorry, surcharge of 25%, which makes it 75%. Cess at 3%, Nobody knows because it did not be dwelled down to the states under the sharing system. Any cess collected by the union is not passed down to any of the states. It's with the consolidated fund and the union will spend it the way it wants. They need to lay down a statement of account for that, but that's outside the purview of this discussion. And no deduction shall be. Which means for, if you're saying for reflecting under the return of income under 139, which is the period 1/4/2016 to 31/3/2017. Any cash credit in the, when total income includes any cash credit under 68. 68 is known as cash credit, colloquially 68. If there is a cash credit from 1/4/2016 till 31/3/2017, you are wanting to tax me at 77.25 if I don't come out voluntarily. You also have something else. You can levy penalty. Look at this. This is the Pradhan Mantri scheme later, but on one hand, you look at it, 115 BB, 60% adding up to 77.25. Let's be clear on numbers here. Now, you have some scheme which we will discuss later called Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. So, what is this for the welfare of the poor? People who do not have employment or whatever, we are wanting to give them some money so that probably they will become much more resilient in not getting out to work. They can sit at their homes. Some governments will provide them TV, washing machine, fridge as a part of electoral promises. Somebody else will give them mobile phones. Somebody else will give them laptops as thing. Somebody else would, in whatever scheme card, they will say 100 days of definitive employment at least one day. So on and so forth. Ultimately, at the end of 365 days, you will probably lure them with some more goodies. Come back to par and say there is economic boom. Where is it? You are making people lazy. It is not a question of you giving a compulsory 100 day employment. There is no roadmap to say how the situation is going to get better and how the self-sustenance model will start for them. You are saying if as long as I am in power, you will get 100 days work. What does it mean? It's an indirect way of threatening. If you don't vote me to power, you will not have these 100 days of work. Some other government will say, look, 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 he's only 100 days, I'll give you 175 days. Bumper hit, 175 days. In all the centers, 175 days, please come, collect your money, go back. Now, they've introduced this scheme, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, for deposits. If a person does not declare undisclosed cash deposit in an account between 1st April to 15th December, because this scheme came in with effect from 16th December, rules have been notified on 16th December under the Pradhan Mantri whatever scheme, which is the rate applicable. The CBDT circular says under amended 115 BBE, I will bring to tax, which means from 1/4/2016 to 15/12/2016. Now we will discuss whether this is retrospective or prospective. What is the majority view here? Is it retrospective or prospective? Can the rate of tax be levied with retrospective effect? No doubt Parliament has got the power to make laws which are retrospective in nature. There is no doubt on that. There are enough and more Supreme Court judgments on that to say that. Kutbik ordinance for the state of Baloch is one example, dealing with municipal taxes under the then state Baloch municipality. So it is very well established that you can retrospectively make laws. We are not saying retrospectively charge more. Parliament has got the powers to amend a law with retrospective effect. Now, is it retrospective or prospective is the question. If the view is that it is retrospective in nature, when the so-called demonetization of old currency happened on 8/11/2016, how can you say the money or whatever from 9th of November, that particular whatever was earlier known as currency, according to which pieces of paper? Pieces of paper in XYZ denomination, color, numbered as written 1000 in between, numbered as whatever series, That should be the document reference for that. You can't see this 1,000 rupees note. The moment it is ceased to be legal tender, you cannot say it is a old 1,000 rupees. It was a erstwhile legal tender. If you find something on that, you should say, they found one piece of paper using so and so dimension, written 1,000. There is a watermark of one gentleman there. They also have one code on the right hand side corner and one number on the left hand side corner. This is the description of the so called paper, which is called as the erstwhile currency note. If you are
specified
bank. What is specified bank?
500,000.
No, I am saying after it ceased to be legal tender, I am saying it's a piece of paper. How can it be a bank note? Because they are not honoring the promise. What does the note say? The RBI government says, I promise to pay the bearer of this a sum of rupees so and so. Which means, if the government has brought out a notification saying through an ordinance saying after December 30 I won't do it, it's a violation of the sovereign promise. Initial, there was time given. The flip flops are for everybody to see. They said 5,000 and above. Give a declaration why you did not deposit before that. What was the initial sovereign promise? There's a concept of promissory estoppel which is well known in income tax laws. That is, once a government under the scheme of taxation or any other thing makes a promise to its citizens for a particular set of circumstances to prevail and citizens accordingly act on that sovereign promise, you can't take away the right from them and say, look, what you've done is illegal, because it is the simple thing is citizens can cheat government. We're not saying you should cheat. You can cheat, but the government cannot cheat you because he is there to govern and that sovereign promise has to be upheld. So the knee-jerk reaction saying, look, oh, somebody exchange more, I will ink him. Was it legal? Was it legal?
Yes. Supreme Court has said it is legal.
Wait, sir, gentlemen, now there's a thing. As per the Election Commission rules, the inedible ink cannot be used for Negotiable Instrument Act transactions because under the Negotiable Instruments Act, read with the Banking Regulation Act of 1949, with respect to an account holder and a bank, this is not what one of the more specified for withdrawing of money. No, exactly. Under the banking, regulation between me and the banker, you cannot bring in what is not in the statute to say, I am going to ink you from tomorrow.
Why not?
Why not? It does not belong to that. Notification was taken out in a day. The concept was promissory estoppel.
What were the reasons people wrote in those 2-3 days? In the 2 days period or 1.5 days window when the particular scheme prevailed, saying for deposit of more than 10 notes or 5,000, I don't remember the denomination because too many changes have taken place. It is beyond comprehension, say whether it was 5,000, whether it is 10,000, or whether it was 10 notes, 20 notes, whatever the number was, they wanted the customer to explain in writing in the presence of 2 bank officials saying why I could not, and the banker should have accepted that. There are bank branches which are known as one-man branches, also established in the country, in rural parts and rural parts, wherein all the transactions are handled by one gentleman, though because the limits set are low for them. Which means at some point in time, in one of the branches at least, that thing could not have been satisfied. Next. The question was, you deposit in one go, don't come to me multiple times after December 15th, that is why? What was the promise made on November 8th? Don't rush to the banks. You have time till December 30th. The pain will ease down, the queues will come down. You can walk into the bank branch and deposit. Once the people started writing the reason, in colloquially known as, I believe the PM, I believe the FM, in income tax parlance, it is something known as, or the legal parlance, promissory estoppel, which was being broken. The sovereign promise was being broken. Since the sovereign promise was at stake, that particular notification was taken away and sent to deposit. Now, coming to 115 BB and 60%, the understanding is that if it is retrospective, it is illegal. Because what is 115 BB? If there is any income referred to in the nature of 68, 69A, 69BCD, either you declare or the officer finds out, for assessment year 1718, the rate of tax is 60%, which means there must be a cash credit. What is the underlying period? 1/4/2016 to 31/3/2017. There is no break in between to say deposits made on or after 8/11/2016 will get this new scheme. Then maybe it is valid because read with the intention. The legal would have been challenged, but prima facie, there would have been a case saying we didn't want the so-called ill-gotten wealth to get taxed at 30% because honest taxpayers have already paid 30%. Now, assuming you have a cash credit on 1st April 2016 or for that matter take a period after the due date for advancement, because let's be extra careful in saying that if you go back and say you had a cash credit on 1st April, they may say the installment due was on June 15th. Though paying of interest is a punishment for not having declared or paid advance tax then, be that as it may, there can be argument saying there was an advance tax due date, you didn't comply, which means this is that money. Okay. When is the second installment? September. Third one was December. So if anybody has got a cash credit after September 15th, 2016, on or after 8th November also, what was the rate of tax prevalent on the date of me amassing that cash credit? It was 30%. Now you are saying, when I am assessing, I am going to assess it at 60%. It is nothing but retrospective amendment to the section, because you have gone back and said from 1st April 2016, you are taxing me at 60%, that was never in the scheme of the Act, because as on the date of the particular section getting amended or on the day when the taxation law scheme was sought to be amended, the law of the land that stood was under 115 BBE, the rate of tax was 30%. So, in my personal opinion, even if we get notices saying it's 60%, I firmly believe we need to offer only at 30% and not get bogged down by the notices, because it is patently illegal, point number one. Point number two, when there is a cash credit in the books of accounts and you are saying it is on 1st April, or 2nd April and you pay with interest for deferment of advance tax and other things. When does the burden shift? You are saying, yes, I have got a cash credit. The government says nothing doing, you got it after 8th November. Good. The government says it is after 8th November, which means it is in that demonetized currency. Something which is not a legal tender, there is a Karnataka High Court judgment reported in 282 LDR 490 dealing with the erstwhile demonetization in 1977. If any person is found with old high denomination notes after the date of it ceases to be legal tender, it ceases to be legal tender, it can't be unaccounted money because it is not money. So, when it's not money, you can't tax me. That is one argument of it. So, it is for the government to prove I have a cash credit after November 8. What is cash credit? In new currency. Here they have not said the cash credit or building or whatever it is. It is whether they have not specified which currency. So, it is for the department to prove that the credit in my books or credit, not whether the books are maintained or not, with me for the SSE happened after a particular date. Legitimate address, they may try to attack me on 115 BP. If I maintain whatever rough cash book or rough book or whatever, those sheets of paper, I write down all the entries. Those additions are being made. Though there is a landmark celebrated judgment of in L.K. Advani or others in the Jain Hawala case wherein they said, mere notings or loose sheet of paper cannot be taken as evidence. As recently Supreme Court in Sahara's case also said that loose notings. Assuming that we concede that okay, there are notings made and they are incriminating in nature, saying that I have received money from XYZ sources or unexplained money, whatever. If I am wanting to offer it to tax, then what rate should I offer? How does the Act compel me to offer something at 60% when the rate was not existing when I made that money? As on the date of me getting the cash credit or making a unexplained purchase or investing in a property with unknown sources of income, what was the punishment that could have been given to me? You will levy tax under 115 BBE, 30%, plus whatever. If at all you have conducted such, it's a different matter altogether. We are talking in regular scheme wherein you are not caught. But you suddenly wake up one day saying, look, I want to come clean. There's a lot of amnesty schemes as well, which is being given out for various people and other things. So this is one such thing. You get up one fine morning and say, you smell the coffee and say, good, today I'm coming clean. I want to pay advance tax. What's the rate? Consult your CA. Fine, pay 30% of the total amount, whether depending on the advance tax due dates. It's no longer permissible now. Because there is an amendment which says, it is 60%. And they are saying you can deposit even money accumulated before 1/4/2016 that you are forced to declare under Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. And this is only for banking accounts. We will discuss the Pradhan Mantri scheme a little later. But this is the impact. In my personal view is that the amendment which has been though touted to be from 1st April 2017 according to me it's a retrospective amendment. Because for reasons which you have discussed, it was not there, I repeat, on the date of me amassing that cash credit or investment in the property or money. So it was not there. And rate of taxes generally come in the Finance Act to be taxed for the next year. It's not during the year that we don't change tax slabs and rates and deductions. How many benevolent provisions have been introduced during the year? You have this ADC. How many times amendment has taken place saying with effect from 14th of July, whichever date, ADC has been increased to 2 lakhs? How many times? Zero. How many times has a housing loan deduction increased from which is 150 and 2 lakhs now to say 2.5 or 3 lakhs or whatever number? Zero. How many times the standard deduction in the salary regime was in force increased during the year? Zero. Again, zero is a good thing because our own fellow invented it. He was proud of it. Even all this is zero, but he said, see, I don't like like this concept of, I want to change. Something has not been done in the past. I want to make it happen. So I will change it during the year without properly understanding the ramifications that this particular section is going to have. The notices are going to come to people. How do you explain? Let's look at the practical problem of it. How do you explain to an officer that you had this cash credit or money with you in July of 2016? How? I'm not saying this is in cash. You've deposited money in July. Take a situation. Let's not now harp about saying whether I was holding money in cash. No. You hired some transactions. Okay, somebody has paid you through RTGS. You've not accorded it. Unexplained cash credit for some transaction. They paid you money. July of 2016. You would obviously wait until March to decide. Hey, what to do? How do we go about? 60%? No, that's what the law as of today amendment says. So which I am sure would be challenged the moment the first notice is issued. Just a matter of time that first notice lies on anybody's doorstep, and anybody who wants to take the legal route will file a probably a writ against it saying that the notice could not have been issued for this particular purpose, because it is the burden automatically shifts to the revenue once I'm able to establish that I didn't have it after November 8th. It's all. After November 8th, look at such provisions, you know, you'll understand the difference why I'm harping so much on November 8th. In 115 BBE, there's no reference to November 8th or the date on which the presidential assent was received. But in 271, AAC, if income is not voluntarily disclosed by justice, that is, for income referred to under 115 BBE, to the extent it is not covered by 271 AAB for search. So if somebody is fortunate enough that he or she has not been searched, 271 AAB does not apply. 271 AAC applies. So if you have not voluntarily declared at 60%, and the officer finds out there is a credit in your bank, some RTGS or check transaction in the month of July 2016, you are supposed to pay, apart from tax, 10% penalty. So what is the rate of tax go up to? 60%, less 15%, less surcharge, 71.25. I have not paid 71.25. Because I thought promissory estoppel, I followed the law of the land, I went by the amount, and assuming, take a situation of somebody has paid advance tax. There is a cash credit in the month of May, say May 30th, or check received. He or she knows that it can't be explained, or he can't tell from whom the money came, or whatever reason. Entire advance tax, what ought to have been paid, was paid by June 15th. Then what happens? Will the section change? No. You will still be charged for deferment of advance tax, because rate of tax was 60%, you computed as if it was 30%, because you should have envisaged a situation wherein, because some great figures in historical India have had that thing wherein realizations under the trees and something, you should have envisaged a situation wherein there may be a possibility of rate of tax going up from 30 to 60 or 75 or 85 or 90. Might as well, in the best interest of the country and national interest and being patriotic and being only for India, pay advance tax in June itself at 60 or 75%. Only for such of those people who have this type of enlightenment, 234 B and C interest will not be charged. Mere mortals like you and I will have to pay interest at 234 B and C, because we could not envisage that the rate will be increased during the year despite having paid advance tax. And officer, now if he finds out the same check, he can levy 10% of the amount as penalty. So this is where the 271 AAC takes us to. 115 BBE is 60% irrespective of the date. 271 AAC, he finds out, add 10% more. The effective rate will be 84.98%. What is the motivation for somebody to disclose it? Now take a situation, I say gift receipt. unknown sources of gift, what is the rate of tax? 156. Whether you tax it as gift, for taxation of gifts, you have to identify the donor and the creditworthiness. I will say, my maid servant gifted me a sum of 25 lakhs. Department will say, the donor doesn't have the creditworthiness, I will not accept the donor status, it is taxless income from other sources. What is the rate of tax? Hey sir, forget slap sir. Let's be benevolent. For the nation, 30%. For the nation, 30%. Can that be treated as cash credit? I have voluntarily declared it as under and have paid the tax, saying non-relative. It's not a question of I'm saying it is from relative and exempt. No, non-relative, exceeding the threshold limit of 50,000. I have paid the taxes. Offering it under or rather paying advance tax with computation, saying it is 56. Can the officer change it to 68? Possibly yes. If just because you say it is a gift, he need not agree. Because you say it is sale proceeds, he need not say it is sale proceeds. You may say it is unexplained cash credit. Why I am saying this is, we have recently filed a writ petition in the High Court on a similar case wherein the assessee has manufactured the goods, excess duty paid, sold the goods, sales tax collected, sales tax paid, and when the sales have happened in cash. Cash has been received and deposited into the bank. The officer has treated that particular deposits into the bank as unexplained cash credits by stating that you made sales, I agree. That money is not this. The money what you deposited is not from your sales. This is some other money. Please pay 30% of the money deposited to the bank. We didn't file appeal to CAD appeals because we felt it was an order which needs only to be quashed and not appealed against. But if this has happened for a year when things were normal and growth was good in the economy at 7-8%, now take the situation with 115 BBE, rate with 271 WAC. How the assessments are going to be conducted practically. Let's not discuss theory, you're saying you submit a reply, you will acknowledge, you won't acknowledge. That's the theoretical aspect. Practical aspect of it is, it's going to be high-pitched or multi-high-pitched assessments. It's not even going to be normal high-pitched. Because even their board of our replies when we write for the stay petition saying, it's a high-pitched assessment, kindly grant a stay. Now probably you have to invent. Saying, it's a multi-high-pitch assessment. We believe that it was 30% and it's been taxed at 60%. We have preferred an appeal or final rate. Okay. So, the provisions are a deterrent for compliance. What came in as a measure to curb black money or concealment of income now is a deterrent because high rates of taxes traditionally, historically have proved to be measure defer or deter from paying taxes and not voluntarily coming forward to pay the taxes. 271 AAC is what? 114 by 60% plus what of 77 plus 10% will end up paying 85% as the tax. 271 AAB, which is for penalty where search has been initiated. The regular penalty, the regular changes in penalty we discussed in the second half of this discussion. This is, in case when a search has been initiated on or after the first year of July 2012, look at the difference here. The first year of 2012 was always in the statute, it's not something new. But before the date on which taxation laws received the assent of the president. So when the amendment came in, 271 AAB, the first portion was retained saying what was only up till July 2012 because earlier we went to a certain penalty under a different section. Before the assent of the president, that is, in this situation to understand it, after November 8th, somebody has been searched, before the president gave the assent on 15th December or whichever date for the scheme to come in, the old rate applied. See here. Assessee admits 10%, does not admit but files will return 20%, other cases 90% with effect from 1/4 was 60 taxes or penalty under such cases, before the president gave the assent to the particular provision, the old rates apply. They never said it is even for that. The new thing is, on or after, when a search has been initiated under 132, on or after the date on which the taxation law second amendment bill receives the assent of the president, which is after 15th December 2016, if any such has been initiated, what is penalty? In addition to tax, a sum computed rate of 30% of undisclosed income is specified here. If the SSC admits, specifies the manner and substantiated basis, or 60%, which means for penalty under such, there is a clear demarcation that the increased rate of penalty is applicable only after the date on which the particular provision has been given the assent by the president. Such a thing is not existing for 115 BBE. 115 BBE now is for the previous year, 1/4/2016 to 31/3/2017. For penalty under such, clear demarcation. So there is application of mind in so far as drafting of this provision is concerned. Probably the lack of it when the amendment was proposed and passed on 115 BBE. Because this is what I want to highlight the difference when I said a while ago that the date is very important. The date on which it is received assent has a greater consequence here, because such before 15th December also, that is after 8th November, though you are caught with demonetized currency or huge stacks of cash, the penalty under 271AA was only limited to the earlier. Because penalty cannot be levied retrospectively. You can't change the penalty because it's penal in nature, it's a punishment. But even for the tax rate, though there are judicial pronouncements to say that there can be amendment, now it is taking the nature of retrospective amendment. No doubt, the Vodafone controversy is all about a retrospective amendment to the law. So we can't say that the retrospective amendment is not valid because there is a provision to upward. The only method could have been to amend the act. Now they have amended to suit them. Even then, it was amended to suit the government or the department. Even now, it's amended to suit them. So the outcome was, in one place, the Supreme Court gave a judgment in favor of the SSC. Government went against it. Then, now, in anticipation of SSCs being smart, because not everybody is having that 100 day scheme and working. No, somebody are actually smart. Somebody are reading, getting educated, going to college, reading up, doing some courses. So, because there are some people who are actually smart for probably exploring the loopholes of the law, and believe me, unless the loopholes in the law are exploited and pointed out by so-called experts, the law will not undergo a change. How does it undergo a change? Because the draftsman is not God. People who may dispute God, let's not get into that. But the draftsman is not God, therefore he may commit a mistake. Once you exploit it, there should be according to me a reward given. If somebody finds out a loophole in the law and exploits it, it must be a reward given to him saying, you pointed out a mistake that I made, thank you. But what's happening? How dare you point out a mistake? You are liable to tax the devil for yesterday. In fact, they want to even tax what your grandfather's income is saying retrospectively. If you look at how the IDS came in, there was one provision or one section under 197 of the IDS scheme. Well, according to the department, they can go back for n number of years. They don't have to go back for 16 years. How? 20 years? How? IDS is not giving a deadline, but IDS was subservient to Income Tax Act. Firstly, the Income Tax Act must provide that you can tax income beyond 6 years normally, or assets held outside India for more than 16 years. Without which, an independent provision like IDS could not have charged tax for the previous 20 years. So now, this is where the situation is. For take a legal situation of you getting caught with, you don't agreeing to pay income. In such cases, after 15th December 2016, You will be taxed as per 115 BBA, 60% of income, because you can't substantiate the manner of deriving. If you got some money which is supposedly not to be disclosed, why will you disclose the nature? That is why it is undisclosed income or unexplained cash credit. Because you can't substantiate and you don't want to not pay tax. Mention from where you got it. Well, we need to pay tax. You are a nationalist for the country, want to pay taxes, we will pay our taxes, it's TDS, TCS, VAT, service tax, excise, so on and so forth, but you will have forward filled roads. Because that will be filled up only when the election comes. That's a secondary footing. But we are now talking law. 115 BB is 60%. Because you have not admitted during such 60% less 25% surcharge less 3% cess plus 60% penalty, it may add up to 137.25. The card is 100 rupees and you say, I can't tell you. First, you will tell you 60 rupees is 115 BB. How will he correct this 77.25? So, we will attach property saying, you earn 100 rupees, you are liable to pay 137.25. This is the law as it stands today. If there is a search which takes place today and you are not able to explain the sources, firstly under 60% because of 15 PPE, because the entire year is covered, because you are not able to explain, 60% is penalty. Small 25% of penalty is surcharge. So when you are paying 60%, 25% of that has to be accommodated. So 60 plus 15, 75%, and of course you have to pay cess, because you have higher education cess, Swachh Bharat cess, Swachh Kalyan cess, because you have to support the enterprise. So you pay all those things and end up paying 137.25%. What happens if you disown the entire 100? Then it's not mine. So take it up. Take it up. Not mine. You found it with me, it's not mine, I don't know.
That's the thing.
Because there's a presumption in the law saying whatever is found in your premises is yours. Fine. Yes. Come down. Yes, it's mine. I will also say, one gentleman owes me 1,000 crores, please collect it from him. If you ask me evidence for that, I will say, prove that this is mine. I can't explain, I will tell you a certain name. So it's a long, drawn out battle. Generally, 137.25% of whatever normally should not be collected. It's not a question of being pro-department or anti-department. You are caught with 100 rupees. You are wanting to collect 137.25 from him. Where will we get the 37.25 from him? You want to? Is assess another thing you want to? Fine, you know that. What happens? Is the economy going to grow because of such a measure? The fellow who had one house, he will suddenly come back on the road, will want to indulge, it's a behavioral trait. When you say go digital, it can't be overnight. It's a behavioral trait that you imbibe. So therefore, by saying I will tax you for another 37.5% if I catch you, you're always thinking, fine, let's wait for the day when you try to catch me, because I'm very sure that people will not want to pay 60% upfront and say others are getting scot-free. What happens to the taxation of, there is 115 BBE, there is 271 AAB, 271 AAC. You see one small aspect of income tax, taxation of political parties. No law, no transparency, less than 20,000 vouchers also need not be maintained. It is sufficient, self-declaration is sufficient if they say you have received a sum of rupees less than 20,000 in cash. Is taken as sacrosanct. Rest is all through checks, because Companies Act provides that there can be political donations, of course, you want corporate names, etc. But the majority portion of it is cash. They don't pay income tax. The returns are not for public to be seen. It can't be disclosed in RDA. They are supposedly for the people. You can't question me. I may have a fund. More than 20,000, less than 20,000. What was amendment is the last thing? Political parties can deposit as much cash as they want, and there will be no witch hunt. Who's going to witch hunt them? Who's going to witch hunt? So, you deposit. You deposit cash into the bank. No questions asked, because all that you have to do is give a declaration in specified form, prescribed by prescribed authority, like I so and so president of the party or general secretary or secretary as the case may be, hereby solemnly certify that all the donations received by various people are less than 20,000 in cash. The list is as follows. I can even give the photocopies of the phone directory. Doesn't matter. I may give, not mandatory, because I need not maintain records less than 20,000 in cash. Therefore, chunk of the thing is taken care of. Mere mortals like you and I are debating today, probably when the organizer is now definitely signed for coffee, saying that whether 60% tax has to be paid, whether 25% surcharge has to be paid, on top of it whether you should pay 137.25%. This is where the scheme of amendments with respect to demonetization in total. This is the only 3 or 4 amendments. Now we come to the last of the amendments, which is Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. The scheme shall come into effect from 17th December and applicable up to 31st March. It means technically somebody can still today hold the gold notes with the fond hope that he may be entertained under Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. Really don't know as to whether somebody would have actually gone ahead and retained the money with them, because as at even December 30th, the deposit in forms were not released. So if somebody had taken a conscious call saying, no, I will go for this, on 38th December he was not sure whether the forms will come in, whether they will increase the rate of tax suddenly from 50 to 60 or 60 to 75. There was no mechanism known, but anyway, they brought in the scheme. Look at the objective here. In the wake of declaring specified bank notes as not legal tender, there have been representation and suggestions from experts that instead of allowing people, look at this, that instead of allowing people to find illegal ways of converting their black money into black again, what does it mean? Instead of allowing people to find illegal ways, how can there be a presumption that everybody is wanting to find illegal ways to convert their black money into black again? The government should give them an opportunity to pay taxes with heavy penalty, allow them to come clean, so that not only the government gets additional revenue for undertaking and for the welfare of the poor, but also for the remaining part of the declared income, legitimately comes into the formal economy. Thus, money coming in from additional revenue or so-and-so could be utilized. They have never even admitted that will be utilized. Could be utilized for the welfare of the poor. There can never be a definitive statement saying, I will spend on the poor. I could. The intention has been God sent. Implementation is not failure. Help it. But just because there may be a small failure after all of your human beings.
Human error.
Human error. Prayer is human, no? Who is going to forgive? Who is going to forgive? Now, larger than life figures available to forgive you. You can't say with political affiliations. There are larger than life figures who may be anointed as God or otherwise to forgive. So, this could be utilized. So, this is the objective. So, our fundamental assumptions what we made in the beginning still continue to hold good, because it's again only for the welfare of the poor. Why they remain poor, you are not supposed to question. Because if you question, you know the methods what you are supposed to say. You are not national, you have no patriotism, and you have to go to an every country. So, with that being the backdrop, it could be utilized for the welfare of the poor. What will they do? For programs of irrigation, we know the Maharashtra scam of dams and irrigation. Housing, we have the HEDCO scam. Toilets, I don't know whether there is any scam already on this. Maybe something in Swachh Bharat might have already come up. Infrastructure, we have the Commonwealth Games scam. Primary education, the school buildings being used for something else and no teacher and ghost salary, teachers taking up salary, this primary education, etc. for the welfare of the economically weaker sections of the society. So this is the amount how it will be spent. So we know how this money is going to be spent. Deposit of cash out of receipts up to 8/11/2012 may be dealt in following months. Possession explained out of income of the year or accumulation over the years. So even accumulated income of the years, you are supposed to come clean and say this Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, not 115 BPE, because government does not know whether it is this year or last year. So, if it's before 8th November, one section of the so-called experts argue that it should be only 30% opting for this scheme. Of course, there's a benevolent thing there. To opt for the scheme is optional and the discretion of the person, and you are assured of certain immunities. Includes, does not, this includes, see, this is a procedural thing, does not include the same in total income, the idea may provide, may not provide. Those are not really matters of consequence, because the money is taken away first of all. It doesn't matter whether you include the last line in the ITR, last part line, or you sign us. It is not this. A person can make a declaration of any income in the form of cash or deposit in an account maintained in a specified entity. Specified entities, RBI, post office, cooperative bank, are legal entities only. They are not saying you had a deposit with between two money lenders, you had a deposit and you come clean and say it is. No. If you had a deposit with any of these people, for any assessment year commencing on or before 1st April 2017, no deduction shall be allowed. That's of course. You have the income, 50% will go as tax. These are the specified entities. 30% is a tax. Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan says, so 33% of the tax is says for the welfare of economically weaker sections of the society, and there is a benefit for you. No education cess is payable because it is for the welfare of the poor. You will not need to educate them, so therefore there is no education cess required there. No education. You give them food, laptop, mobile, etc. So no education cess there. Effective rate becomes, I think it's 49. After penalty it's 49.9. Because of course you will pay penalty also for not having come clean and you have accumulated money over the years. So there must be some leverage. You have a benefit in the form of no education cess being paid. Therefore it's compensated by a small matter of 10% as penalty, adding up to 49.9%. Good. It doesn't end there. The person making a deposit shall deposit an amount not less than 25%. It is not even 25%. Which means voluntarily somebody can deposit more also. Now out of 100 rupees, such 49.9 goes out as welfare, not only tax. You have Garib Kalyan says and penalty on that and other things. Can't colloquially call everything as tax now. You have to call as Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan says, because it is for a specified purpose they are collecting. Says, mind you, is for a specified purpose only. If they are saying that it is for the welfare of economically weaker section of society and for the poor, it should go only to them. Who are poor? Gentlemen, don't question the definition of who are poor, because that is not in the name, in the interest of national security. Those definitions will not be revealed to the peer markets. The deposits are interest free and have a lock-in period of 4 years. So 4 years your money will be with them. So CRR of the banks and the banks will be flush with funds. They can be used to give loans. To whom? No. When it comes to giving of loans, you have the banking norms which say priority sector lending, you will give it to maybe to any business entity. You have this again various schemes wherein to poor you can give only a portion. Am I right, sir? Under any banking regulation, you have a percentage of your entire loans to be given out to one section of the society, one for infrastructure, one for mining, etc., whatever, priority sector lending. So this money will go back into the system. So that's a legitimate scheme and the deposit shall be. At the end of it, you will be left with 25%. And of course, the next year during scrutiny, it may be treated as, because you never know whether the declaration given by you will be treated as valid by deposit. Because you can't make a declaration, the tax, surcharge and penalty along the deposit has to be made before filing of declaration. So you have to pay all the things and make a declaration. For various reasons, the declaration can also be rejected. See, there is a method, by and large, you believe that the norms won't be violated and continued. But though this is a cause of concern and we are laughing it off, there is a possibility that for whatever reason, how many persons for whom the Prevention of Corruption Act is applicable will come under this zero. Because they can't declare it. They can't declare it because being in government service, you could not have amassed that 20%, 25% deposit in collected bank. So there are host of people who cannot declare also. There is that particular scheme. It does not apply to FERA, Narcotic Drugs, Unlawful Activities, Prevention of Corruption Act. Had they brought this now, saying this time the amendment of 50% without questions being asked, the declarant name not being made public, will apply to Prevention of Corruption Act also, maybe in the better wisdom of a lot of people, higher amount of deposits would have come. At some point in time, people want to come clean. That is a presumption. With that presumption, maybe people would have come clean, because there is an open window for all the monies accumulated over the past many years in ways which were not legal then, become legal by virtue of the immunity being provided. Now, why are different immunity schemes coming in now? When the 1997 BDI scheme came in, this honest taxpayers filed a PI in the Supreme Court saying the rate of tax is 30%, even for us we have paid over past many years. The so-called unscrupulous people who evaded tax for all this year, they were given immunity again by having the same rate of tax. So Supreme Court laid out a guideline saying you cannot have this amnesty scheme coming in. No problem. Change the name, formerly known as. It is now income declaration scheme, Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan scheme. My thing is, if IDS was now probably touted to be a, you should not say failure, not very successful. Can't say it is not successful. Say it is not very successful, or it is moderately successful, or it is likely successful. Because the original estimate was 65,250 crores by 64,000 individuals, adding up to crore and above. Then you got some declarations which were made in the wake of notes not getting demonetized, that you offer 45% and give you 55%. Now, since the 55% had to automatically come into the system to exchange, the 10,000 crores declaration went away. Now it said 55,000 is the thing for 64,000 people. About 85 lakhs or something is per person, compared to 4 lakh people coming clean in VDIs. The quantum may be less to the inflation adjusted rates in 97, but are we saying the number of people who are holding black money has come down from 4 lakhs to 64,000? Is anybody in agreement with that number? People with black money were 4 lakhs in 1997, it's come down to 64,000, whatever number, less than 64,000 in 2016? No. Which means, on one hand, you implemented the guidance of the Supreme Court, but the scheme was not brought out properly. Anyway, the pitfalls are over, the scheme is over. It was likely successful. Now came in Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan scheme. This declaration may be considered as void and shall be deemed never to have been made if the declaration is made by misrepresentation or suppression of facts when no questions are being asked as to how is the accumulation of past years, and I declare say 100 crores out of accumulation of past years. It can be void by misrepresentation or suppression of facts. I am not able to comprehend what sorts of facts that we need to put forth. Is it for me to prove that I am not covered under Narcotic Drugs and FERA, Prevention of Corruption and others, to say positively I am not covered there? It's something like I am wanting to prove the negative. If you ask me, do you have an account in State Bank of India? I can say yes. And if I have an account, I can show you the passbook. How can I prove I don't have an account with them? How do I prove that I don't have an account with State Bank of India? Affidavits is not self-serving statements, sir. Affidavits, notarized affidavits, sworn before magistrate, are all self-serving statements. How do you prove to the satisfaction of the department that you do not have an account in State Bank of India? So when you say it will be void by misrepresentation and suppression of facts, all that I am required to do is, I had accumulated earnings over past years, I am wanting to contribute now to the economically weaker section of society, therefore I have come forward to deposit the money, 50%, 25% and etc. Now it will be void. So it shall never be deemed to have been made. The Second and third are in agreement because without payment of tax, surcharge and penalty, you declare it void, agreeable. Without depositing the required amount in the deposit scheme, agreeable. Point number one, difficult to comprehend. Consequently, no protection will be applicable, available to such declarants under the scheme. So, if at all you have woken up and decided to come clean to promote and support economically weaker sections of the society by opting to come under Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, am I right on the wording because it confused. Then you are supposed to give a particular fact. Failure to do so will result in that income being 60%, penalty, other things may go up to 85% is sure, 84.98 is sure, because you are not in search, no? Because of that they may search you, they will find the same amount of papers which you wanted to declare and other things. Because of that, the rate goes up to 137.25. The other rules are anyway consequential in nature. Declaration of income in the form of assets like jewelry, stock of immovable property, not eligible, has to be only cash or deposit. Interbank deposits also can be declared. You have account, as I said, money received through check or banking channels on 5th May 2016. Maybe you want it to be advanced in your books. Department may say it is 115 BBE. Possible. And if any notice has been issued, scrutiny, reassessment, search, people can avail the scheme. The moment a notice is issued, they have to wake up and say, look, you issued a notice to me, you may collect 137.25 from me, I might as well come and pay totally 75 and wait for my 25 to come back. A person on whom such a survey has been initiated is eligible to file a declaration in respect of the undisclosed income. Cash seized can be declared. No, what do you mean by no credit for advance tax? Not the, on the amount of this. If you have any other credit of advance tax of TDS or TCS, you can't claim credit of that against this. You pay separate. Ultimately, the fundamental law is that you have to pay 75% of this income. How does it matter whether the 75% you already paid 5% earlier? 75% you should pay it now. After you have accepted to support the economically weaker sections of the society. Because when you paid the advance tax, you had not decided to support the economically weaker sections. Therefore, no old credits of TDS can be allowed. And if you have foreign bank accounts, if somebody wants to declare, not eligible. No. All of us know the success story of the foreign money which was brought back and 15 lakhs being deposited into most people's accounts. Those type of accounts are not eligible. Deposits made in bank prior to 1617 can also be declared. For any assessment year, you can declare. Any assessment year, there is no time barring or limitation. Want to declare something for assessment year 1991-1992? I don't know, maybe possible. I am reading this thing with you all. Any prior to financial 1670, it can be made for any of the years. Undisclosed income deposited or repaid in an overdraft account or cash credit account or loan account can also be declared. You already repaid it. You repaid the money to the bank. How do you get the money and pay it back as tax? Where do you generate that fund? Maybe got the answer. The cash seized may be allowed to be adjusted for making of tax or charge and pay. But the amount, you cannot deposit 25% of that in that 25% scheme. For tax advance tax, they will adjust the cash seized. But if you are saying, look, you found 100 from me, take 50 as tax, 25 as deposit. No. 50 for tax is okay, 25 separately bring it. The said amount shall not be allowed to be adjusted for making deposits in the scheme. Somebody is found with 100, is opting for the scheme, 50 rupees goes out in tax, surcharge, penalty, 25 he cannot from this money. He has to borrow and then deposit. Because this money you can't utilize for making a deposit. So even if you have made some advances in cash
other than movable property for services or goods subsequently returned back as the purpose was not materialized. You can still declare. You have made a deposit, you got it back. So nowhere it's, you can still declare. And the benevolent provision is 271 D and E, small penalty sections will not be made applicable to you. So with this, I think we'll break for a cup of tea. We'll come back and discuss the penalty provision. Changes in penalty provisions. When I say recent changes, it's got nothing to do with 8th November 2016. This changes happened a little earlier in the budget amendment itself, but the penalty provisions are slated to kick off from 1/4/2017. So all of us had enough and more notice and time frame to prepare for the eventualities under the new penalty scheme. Been given a new look. One important change is that the satisfaction of the assessing officer now is under reporting. This includes new terminologies. It's more like old wine in new bottle. Under reporting, misreporting. For misreporting to kick in, first it must be under reporting, then it will go back to big B, misreporting, higher rate of. Why did this come in? Army Issuers Committee last year issued a host of recommendations to the government to implement. One of them even was the rate of tax to professionals under preservative scheme that proposed at 33%. The recommendation was well taken. The rate of tax was increased from 33 to 50% when the act came in. So up to 50. Similarly, they have also highlighted the various hardships that the SSCs are undergoing on account of the commonly known 1C penalty, 271 1C penalty, which was being levied as a routine in cases of inadmission. Because there are divergent views of Supreme Court, let alone the High Courts, on what constitutes concealment and what constitutes furnishing of inaccurate particulars. There are two different things, and law is fairly well settled, I would say, but the disputes continue till date. Even today, probably the reply would have filed this notice under 274, red with 271, 1C is bad in law. Because there was an inherent limitation in terms of certain procedural aspects not being proper, and the Justice Army Issuers Committee recommended a host of things, a simplification and rationalization of the penalty provisions, and to be probably to make it more, I would say, simplified, understandable, rather than saying, say, 100 to 300%. So the peak rate of penalty has gone down. What would have been 300% now is 200. The minimum penalty, what was 100, now is 50. There is a overall benefit in so far as the assessee is concerned that the overall penalty rates have come down under this section 270A. Yes, it's come down because you have other sections which you have discussed in the past that we have introduced to garner more revenue. 270A is inserted from 1/4/2017, whereas 271 section does not apply. If you look at the last provision, shall not apply to and in relation to any assessment for the assessment year commencing on or after the first year of April 2017. 271 section says shall not apply to and in relation to any assessment for the assessment year commencing on or after 1st April 2017. So should it be read as assessment for assessment year 17-18 onwards? So which means any penalty which has to be levied for the 16-17 year will come under this. But since 270A specifically says in the effect from 1/4/2017, the common understanding is that any penalty which will be initiated or levied after that date will kick off under the new provisions, because 271 would have had its sunset and 270A
takes birth from that point in time. Two cannot exist together for the same assessment year. Maybe for the earlier years, say for assessment year 11, 12, some assessment is going on now. 148, it gets over. There is probably even a thought or probably a view that if that assessment gets concluded next year, under which section will you levy penalty? You see, it must be under 271(1)(c) because the 271(1)(c) cannot apply to and in relation to any assessment for the assessment year commencing on 1st April 2017. It does not say for any assessment on or after 1st April 2017. If it's any assessment, then even 11, 12, 12, 13, 13, 14, which are due under 148 now can be made permanent. So there is a reasonable, or one view is that for the earlier years, 271(1)(c) will continue to operate. So again, the objective and rationale is well explained for the kind of thing. So 270A, stress is no more under reporting and misreporting. Under reporting is more like furnishing of inaccurate particular income. Misreporting is akin to concealment. This by and large, how we need to probably understand. Otherwise, it takes probably a while for us to get used to saying, okay, under reporting penalty, misreporting penalty. So if this cannot come overnight, go digital also cannot come overnight. From concealment penalty and furnishing inaccurate particulars itself is taking time. How many of us today are saying it's penalty or under reporting? You will still say it is 271(1)(c) penalty. Now no one is misreporting, under reporting, or will you say no, 270A subclause 2 under reporting, subclause 9 misreporting. For next 3 or 4 or 5 years at least, till it becomes a habit or a behavioral trait changes, you will continue to call it as concealment and furnishing inaccurate particulars, which new terminology is being assigned to it in the Act. As you, when you go down to check how the scheme operates, it's not very different from how it could have operated. What is under reporting? Failure to report or reporting less income than actually it is. Furnishing a inaccurate particulars of income. Misreporting. Deliberately reporting false and inaccurate particulars of income. So under reporting is defined under 270A subsection 2 and misreporting under 270A subsection 9. But for 270A subsection 9 to kick in, first you need to prove that there was under reporting of income, which results in misreporting. What is the penalty? If it is under-reporting, now at least you have, there is no distinction between inaccurate particulars and concealment. Both are equally looked at now. Because if you have just omitted to disclose some facts, you are burdened with a lesser penalty, 50% of the amount of tax payable on the under-reported income. Penalty for misreporting is a non-obstantive clause. 270A9 is a non-obstantive clause. Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 6 or 7, where under-reported income is in consequence of any misreporting thereof by a person, the penalty referred in subsection 1, which is 50%, shall be 200% of the amount of tax payable of the reported income. So necessarily, the concealment penalty, first you must be as a consequence of under-reporting. It is not on a standalone basis. If the misreporting is happening on consequence of under-reporting of income, you will be penalized at 200%. What is under-reporting? It's a very exhaustive definition what they've given here. Your returns are filed. The assessed income is greater than the income processed under 143(1)(a). What happens if now CPC is processing? You get a 143(1)(a) information with a demand. As on that date, it is under reporting of income. If for whatever reason you have failed to look into it, or it's escaped your attention, if you don't take corrective steps, it is a straight case of under reporting. So officer has got the power to levy 50% penalty because the assessed income is greater than income processed under 143. This is not the intention. See, honestly, due credit must be given here. See, the intention now is not to tax 50% on any computerized errors that take place. But there is a possibility, but by and large, I think by the time the scheme kicks in and it comes in, suitable circulars and notification amendments are going to come in because this is definitely not the purpose and intention, because otherwise it will be included somewhere else. You need not say the returns are filed. In case of man, the income deemed under 115 JB or JC is greater than the income under 143 1A. So these are the deeming fictions under 143 1A. Probably the if it was manual processing or if 143 1A was happening after some scrutiny at some level by the officer, there can be a rationale behind it. Without scrutiny assessment, but prima facie verification of returns. Like what used to happen earlier, summary assessment where the 141 intimation should be sent after due verification, not a simply return filed and intimation. The records used to be scrutinized with whatever you find, the deduction proof, the TDS certificates and other things, and 143-1 intimations used to be issued. In those circumstances, this was proper. Putting a claim to deduction, not enclosed, you don't have proper proof. Therefore, 143-1 becomes more. May not be for scrutiny or 148 notice, but you claim, say, tuition fees of 1 lakh, but you have only voucher for 50,000. That the officer has to call you and find out and do it, may not be, because on the basis of a return with attachments which you are supposedly filing there, failure to do so could have attracted intimation being on a higher. Now it is being computerized system. How do you differentiate whether there was an error on part of the person in uploading the details or whether there was an error by the processing place? There are n number of circumstances that the CPC processing has had a mistake, and it's not that they have not responded to it. So compared to how the situation was 3 or 4 years ago when we had that seminar in the institute also, where the commissioners came, took our views and also understood where the more mistakes are getting committed by the system of processing, because house property, there was no concept to give a negative number. Even though you enter a negative number, it is to take as positive, and since you were not a filter in the relevant form, it was taking as income from other sources. It was, the error was there for some branches which CPC ultimately rectified. So now under 143-1A, the onus is shifted, which means there needs to be some amount of detailing which goes into before the 143-1 can be given. See, the regular provisions with respect to what constitutes under reporting, misreporting is on one hand. Look at 270A subsection 9, which probably, because under reporting you know that ABC, if you're falling within that, 50%. What are specified cases in 270A9? Misrepresentation or suppression of facts. The element is, what is to be noted here is, penalty provisions have undergone a sea change for the last 30-40 years. Under the 1922 Act, you had penalty under 28(1)(c) of the 1922 Act, which said when a person deliberately furnishes inaccurate particulars of income or deliberately conceals his income. So the stress was on the word deliberately, which means mens rea, guilty mind. You did it with knowledge that you are, that amendment was, there was amendment to the section, the word deliberately was stuck out. Even then, unwilling case is an authority on penalty under 1922 Act, 76 ITR, page number 696. Supreme Court unwillingly analyzed how the penalty provision has been interpreted, especially for concealment penalty, and said, though the word deliberately has been omitted or removed from the section, there is still a prima facie requirement of there being a mens rea inherently involved in arriving at a conclusion that there is a person has furnished inaccurate particulars of income or concealed his particulars of income. That is how the anomalous case was built up.
Subsequently, 1989, again the amendments to penalty came in and the rationalized and they brought in 100%, 300% and furnishing of inaccurate particulars and concealed the particulars. So the penalty law has undergone a change. Now, in my opinion, once you say it is misrepresentation or suppression of facts, how does it kick in? The department now has to establish that I have misrepresented or suppressed the fact. Suppression of the fact is one aspect of it. By and large, dutifully, if they are able to go step by step, maybe they may be able to decipher that yes, look, you had this type of items, A, B, C are suppressed. Misrepresentation of facts again involves a judgment. How a particular fact has to be looked at or how it ought to be looked at. So which means, according to me, the concept of mens rea is indirectly come back into the penalty provisions now. Which means, firstly, now the department has to prove, in my opinion, that there is a deliberate action of mine in either misrepresentation or suppression of facts so as to warrant applicability of 278 subsection 9. So once mens rea kicks in, the burden automatically shifts to the department because you are innocent until proven guilty. That is the law of the land on which our constitution is found. Therefore, if mens rea comes back in an indirect way like this, when you know, if the department is able to, should be in a position to establish suppression or misrepresentation, going to again open a Pandora's box of litigation, not in 1718, maybe in 2021, because by the time the assessment for this year gets over, people file appeal, there is a provision of 275 wherein the matter is in appeal, the penalty will be kept in abeyance. So by then it will take 4 or 5 years, by the time you see serious issues on penalty being raised here. On top of it, if you look at the provision in respect to 271(1)(c) now or any penalty notice for that matter, Karnataka High Court in Majigada Jinning has said, if you are giving a pro forma type of notice without striking off the relevant words, either furnishing inaccurate particulars or concealment, the notice is void ab initio. Therefore, the proceedings concluded on such a notice is void. It is not no next to standing test of law. And recently, Supreme Court has dismissed the SLP against that particular case, which means they have also given reasoning. It's not only they have dismissed the SLP, the operative portion of the Karnataka High Court order is part of the dismissal of the SLP. They are saying they have no reason to interfere with the order of the Karnataka High Court in this matter, which means by and large it's got more persuasive value. Already, by virtue of the jurisdictional High Court judgment, it was binding on the assessors in the state of Karnataka. And since it's a beneficial provision, even though you had a other High Court judgment which was against, for example, jurisdictional High Court against, then that assessee was under a loss, technically with respect to how we are facing the issue with respect to capital gains with diverse case. Karnataka, it is binding. Similarly, for Tamil Nadu, for penalty, there is no judgment is contrary to Panilanda Chini. So, they can follow. For example, if there is a Bombay High Court judgment which is against, in the state of Tamil Nadu, they can choose between Karnataka and Bombay High Court to decide. Whereas for assessees in Maharashtra, though there is a favorable judgment of the Karnataka High Court, the tribunals and courts in Maharashtra will lean towards the jurisdictional, for the primary jurisdiction being Bombay High Court, though they can depart and say the favorable view or the view favoring the assessee must be adopted because it is settled position of law by virtue of Supreme Court judgment in vegetable products 88, 89, 192. We also have Usha Martin Industries. And they say if there are two views possible, the view favorable to the assessee must be adopted. So that is on one hand where the notice itself is getting stuck off. Now under misreporting or underreporting, we have to wait for the notices to come in to see what is the particular satisfaction they record in the particular thing. Now when the 271(1)(c) is being initiated, it is not assuming that the notice is valid. What else are we challenging? We are saying the initiation of penalty is bad enough because we are saying the officer has not recorded a satisfaction. That, what is satisfaction there? It is inherently independent application of mind by the officer to the facts of the case to arrive at a reasonable, legal, logical conclusion that the SSE has either furnished inaccurate particulars of income or has concealed the particulars of income. So there are most of judgments on saying what is satisfaction and the failure to do so, or it can be a mechanical recording of satisfaction. You can say addition of so much has been made, or a one-liner which says after additions, lastly, penalty under 271(c) is being initiated separately. It is not satisfaction. That is only a matter of his, or is stating a fact that he is initiating penalty. Why he is initiating? If not on the order, it must be in his file. The order sheet noting in his file before he sends out the notice must record the satisfaction saying for ABC reasons the penalty notice is being issued. So in cases where you challenge that and say that there is no satisfaction recorded, the penalty will drop. Take example, move away from penalty, come to 153C. Assessment of persons, in case of persons other than one person searched. What does 153 say? In case of a search, if documents of any other person are found, the assessing officer of the person searched must record a satisfaction in his file, that is, in the file of the person searched, that the document or item or whatever belongs to somebody else, and then it must be transferred to the jurisdictional officer. And the board circular in 2015 December says, even though the officer for both of them is the same, the satisfaction must be recorded in the file of the person searched. So if Prashanth is the person searched and some documents pertaining to Mr. Shivmohan are found there, and the officer of assessing both of us is the same, the law under 153C is that my assessing officer has to record in my file stating that this particular document belongs to Mr. Shivmohan, including a nature or otherwise, and forward it to the jurisdictional officer of Shivmohan, which may be the same officer, may be different also, which means recording of satisfaction is important. And the board circular, which came after the Supreme Court judgment in Calcutta in 1962, clearly says if department has filed appeals on these aspects, withdraw them. And if assessee has challenged his satisfaction in the appeal, records have to be called for. If there is no satisfaction, the entire assessment will be set aside. And on 153C. Similar, there is no exact reproduction for the penalty circulars or something, but the law of satisfaction remains the same. Because it is set to position that if something has to be done in a particular way as per a statute, it has to be done in that way alone. That is SPL Siddhartha, Delhi High Court 345, page number 223, which says that even though the notice has to be issued by Assistant Commissioner of Income Tax, Commissioner cannot say, I am superior to him, I will issue the notice. He may be his boss administratively, but the statute requires an income tax officer to issue a notice, only he has to issue it. Even the CC cannot step into the shoes and issue. It is not a question of a lower ranked officer doing the work of a higher ranked officer. No. Obviously, income tax officer cannot sign the appeal paper saying, okay, as commissioner, I'll waive the interest for the 24 weeks. No. Same time, chief commissioner cannot conduct a assessment or issue a notice for assessment unless he is a officer authorized under 120. By virtue of 120 notification, he must be empowered to assess. Just because he is chief commissioner, he cannot step in the shoes of a subordinate officer and issue the notice. Means there is an inherent duty bound rule based law. In the same fashion, satisfaction is a must. Once he has to be satisfied that the SSE has misreported the income, which means he must prove that I have misreported, which means he needs to establish beyond doubt that there is misrepresentation of facts, which according to me
indirectly is leading situation where main CA is bashed. It's not sure because the provisor end to kick in, we're only understanding from what the law is supposed, which will be there on 1/4/2017 and thereafter. According to me, there is every possibility that it can be challenged saying when CA is back in penalty in a new avatar. Next is failure to record investment in the books of accounts. Fine, I maintained books of accounts for 44AA is one aspect of it. What happens to personal investments? We have this concept of filing statement of affairs. What is the requirement in a 44AA? You audit the books of account of a business or profession as the case may be. And you are supposed to only file the only recently in the AK the moment it's saying if the assets and liabilities are more than 25 lakhs or 50 lakhs as the case may be, you issue asset and liability statement. Take the situation of being less than that. The asset or liability is not more than that. Whether personal investments have to be recorded in the books of accounts is a question. Whether non-recording of those investments in the books of accounts, whether will it lead to misreporting? Next, books of accounts not maintained. You earlier had this 271A penalty, 25,000 for not maintenance of books. You always have this debate saying if it's a 44AB case, penalty and which section will be levied, either 271A or B. Central position of one interpretation is that since books of accounts were not maintained, the question of getting them audited does not arise. Therefore, penalty under 271A must be levied because you cannot get the books of accounts audited because it is hit by the doctrine of impossibility of performance. There is no books of accounts to get audited. So, what is the penalty for non-maintenance of books of accounts? 271A said it is 25,000. 271B was maximum of 1.5 lakhs. Maximum 1.5 lakhs. Whatever be the turnover. Less than 1.5 or up to maximum 1.5. If personal investments are not recorded, personal jewelry, is every possibility that SSC is having individual balance sheet, HUF balance sheet, have something called statement of affairs, where in the business balance sheet, these assets might not have been recorded. Is every possibility that, okay, there was a mistake in the return. Let us concede that the return required you to show something last year, you have failed to do that, fine. But the investments are genuine, through known sources, established beyond doubt. See, if it's a doubtful investment, yes, you agree that penalty can be levied. Assuming it's gone through banking channels, it's traversed the entire length and breadth of the department's notice to say that it is genuine. I have not recorded in the books of accounts, but there is enough and more proof. I got the money, capital sale of property, I have sold it, I paid capital gains tax. That is forming part in the return of income, but I have omitted to record it in my what happens? Is it misreporting? And what amount will you levy the penalty? Assuming I have a property, I have sold it, I am showing land in my personal balance sheet, ancestral land, I have sold it, I have failed to record a particular sale, but the taxes on the capital gains have been duly paid, returns filed. I have not recorded that particular transaction of, or I have purchased the land, I am a salaried employee, taxes have been debited source, I have purchased, income is more than 25 lakhs for most professionals and many of the professionals. They have not filed the statement of assets and liability. Land has been purchased through no legitimate sources of income, which is tax suffered and TDS under 192 has been done. Whether that will result in it being misreporting. Genuine case of omission. Salaried employee is into salary is 1 crore per year. 30% tax is already paid. He has 70 lakhs. He has paid 25 lakhs and purchased some 20 quintals of land supply. Since his income exceeds 1 crore and he is supposed to give a statement of assets and liabilities, for whatever reasons, he has failed to disclose that. Does it amount to misreporting?
First of all, whether income has been added to return?
The 1 crore income is there.
Is it relevance or addition?
exactly. For failure to record any investment in the books of accounts. Right, but why is it a failure to record investment in the books of account? I have maintained so called books of account.
So you would explain the sources.
Correct. Yeah. Exactly, which is what my point is. The thing is, by this particular thing saying failure to record investment, a doubt arises whether personal investments need to be recorded. In the 44A, if you're doing the business audit of a professional maintaining books of accounts under 44A, for who was mandated under 44A to maintain the books of accounts, it's a statement of affairs. If he has not recorded some investment, but it is out of known sources.
There is no addition.
There is no addition.
There is a penalty.
There is no penalty, but whether this constitutes
misreporting.
Whether this constitutes misreporting. Whether
misreporting.
Which means there can be a possibility that it is misreporting because the computation provision is failing, you are not bringing it to tax. Assuming there is some other addition made for him saying some FD interest not disclosed of 100 rupees. And, but one crore worth property you have, what do you say, purchased legitimate sources not recorded in your, then what happens?
See, what is the first provision for penalty?
Sir, my point is, what you are trying to articulate is what I am making an issue here. Even though this says that personal investment should be recorded, the mere failure, I am saying in my opinion, does not result in penalty unless the source is undisclosed. Which is what I am trying to do. Because the HUF cases and the individual cases, all of us are aware, there is a concept of statement of affairs which is prevalent outside the business balance sheet, personal assets, personal jewelry, including utensils can form part of the statement of affairs. It can be utensils which have come down the generations, the value of which antique pieces, but it will show as historical value. If they say it's not recorded and give play market value, it will be a huge distortion of facts then. Claim of expenditure not substantiated by any evidence. Now, when you use the word substantiated by any evidence, it gives scope for interpretation. Partially, if you have given documents, it is not claim of expenditure not substantiated by any evidence. Only according to me, if you only on failure to give any evidence, 278, 9 months kicking. Because they have not used the words not substantiated by evidence, they have said by any evidence. Because the word any there contemplates set of evidences, only a few, maybe one. I have 10 bank accounts, I can give you one. You may catch me under the first limb, misrepresentation or suppression of facts. For that you need to prove that there is a guilty mind. For claim of expenditure not substantiated by any evidence, you can interpret the word any to say, even if some documents have been given, something like saying, for framing of assessment under 144, a certain guidelines, if you comply, and if ultimately the officer has completed the assessment based on the information you have submitted, despite your presence not being there, and assessment under 144 being completed, you will say, since the documents have been taken on cognizance, it could not have resulted in a best judgment assessment. It was still a 143 assessment is what the argument always is. Similarly, once I have given some sort of evidences, we should be able to get over claim of expenditure not substantiated by any evidence. Next is recording of any false entry in the books of account. What happens if we don't record it? False entry, penalty. No entry. You can't catch me here because there is no recording of false entry. You cannot say not recording of entry cannot be treated as a false entry. So you must go back to suppression or misrepresentation of facts. I repeat, guilty mind, prove. So the onus is probably getting shifted according to me, in your opinion, to the department more, ultimately they will levy and send it, you find it out. But somebody needs to really apply their mind. There is a fit case for we arguing even our discounts, because if there is no entry made in the books of accounts, there is every possibility to say you cannot catch me under recording of any false entry in the books of accounts. Next is failure to record any receipt in the books of accounts having a bearing on total income. What is having a bearing on total income? Assuming if a particular receipt is a capital receipt or a real receipt, to be judged by the nature of receipt. If I treat it as a capital receipt, it is not having a bearing on the income. Failure to record that. If department tomorrow says it's a revenue receipt, I have not recorded it, does it amount to connected? Possible, because once the nature of receipt has been determined to be revenue nature, my failure not to record it may cause having a bearing on the total income. Possibility. There's every possibility that what we argue as capital receipt, department can take it as revenue. Once it's taken as a revenue receipt, and if I have not recorded that receipt because according to it is capital in nature, no impact on the income, there is a possibility to say there is 270A subsection 9 kicking in. Failure to report any infraction transactions is again, it's a simple reporting mechanism. If you are not reporting any interest transaction.
Supreme Court says,
There may be a 101 reasons for the SSC.20 income. Does not mean every addition should result in. It's not concealment. That was followed in Reliance Petro Project, saying that mere additions and dissolvences does not result in penalty. Supreme Court in MAP data has deviated from Reliance, saying that every addition may result in penalty. Ultimately, when it boils down to SSC, there are two views possible. You find department just cannot take back data and confirm the penalty, because you always have a beneficial provision, and any provision which needs to liberally, which gives some benefit to the SSC, needs to be liberally construed, and this is settled position by Bajaj Kempo's case. So the problem would arise in the how do we substantiate each of them? How do you get out of each of the clauses and say that you are either not misrepresented or suppress the facts? What happens with written furnished for the first time? The return is not furnished and income is assessed for the first time. The in other cases, it is difference between income assessed and basic exemption limit. For the company, for the firm for the first time, what is the difference? So probably as and when the law takes its course and when it comes down, you will have better clarity on the computation mechanism. These are all A, B, C, D, and how the computation mechanisms need to be. This is telescoping of additions. 270A subsection 4 is similar to your 271 section. It's a very past additions will be suitably telescoped. Take a situation wherein when penalty was initiated but dropped, what happens then? Read 270A4, the resource claim to be added, deducted, etc. in prior year, and no penalty was levied for such preceding year, then the under-reported income shall include such amount as is sufficient to cover the debt. No penalty was levied. What happens if penalty was initiated but dropped? Initiated, not levied. Initiated but dropped, because the subsequent action also has been omitted. The outgoing has been. But the department may confound and say that. So we will levy. So far as the revenue is concerned, it is what leans in favor of them is what they take. And when it comes to the SSC, we will follow what is always beneficial to us. In the telescopic provisions here, certain cases excluded from under-reporting. When the SSC offers explanation and the AOC is satisfied that the explanation is bona fide and the SSC has disclosed all the material facts. Now, as the NCA come back, we have already discussed. Competent authority to prove that the said expenditure is not bona fide or no full disclosure. Once I have offered an explanation, according to me it is true and correct and to the best of my abilities, knowledge, information, etc., etc. So it is for the department to prove that it was not proper, it was misrepresenting, misreporting of facts, suppression of facts, the failure to record. It means the onus will be more on the department now. On one hand, it seems easy that they can, they have ABC items to levy penalty. Same time, the challenge is there, it's so much more difficult for them to get over this, because they have to overcome the particular explanation of the SSC to prove that there is suppression and misrepresentation of facts. Failure to do so is fated to the levy of penalty. The amount of underreported income determined on the basis of an estimate. The accounts are correct and complete to the satisfaction of the officer or the appeals commissioner or principal KT. But the method employed is such that the income cannot be deduced. So how do you determine for gross profit estimates, ad hoc additions, ad hoc estimate based? You will offer income based on GP percentage. So what happens in those cases? Whether straight away will you come into misreporting and penalty will be levied? Or it's so easy that okay, ad hoc additions have been made and gross profit is estimated, therefore penalty can be levied. On what ground can they levy penalty if they are estimating GP? You have declared 4.66% as GP. Department wants to make it a 6.25. What is the differential? Which are the facts that I have suppressed or misrepresented? Nothing. It is based on some estimate by the which will be ad hoc or preceding 3 years or 4 years, which the addition to the deduction will be made. Therefore, for gross profit estimation, ad hoc additions, the better part, as they say, this is the better part of valor. We need to see how to exercise the discretion when the notice comes in to say, because in case of GP additions and GP estimates, it's not so easy across the counter to the labor penalty. So there have been various factors which should have been counted in before he makes a GP addition. You know, your shop expenses is less, your salaries is more, your sales purchase price is more, and sales price is to email post of items and I will give an explanation. Saying why my sales dropped during the year. If you ask your automaker why your sales were down during November and December this year, they have an answer. How do you say that is not bona fide? No, last year you sold 25 cars, this year you sold 2. Therefore, your GP will be estimated as if what would have, you would have earned 25. Because you have 20 employees still with you, you are having the same showroom, same 1 lakh square feet of office space, same advertisement expenditure. There is no sales. Ultimately, GP is shown low now, I will increase it. What happens? You give an explanation. Current year, you know the explanation. What happens? Wait. Because, under what date will they? Because under 271AAP, they have brought in here. If the income is if the penalty is being limited in 271AAP and such, it is outside the provisions of 270AL. But take the situation of awaited assessment in 153A. That's just taken place. The assessment is complete. No incriminating documents for that assessment here are found. So the under 153A, the second time the assessment cannot be made, because IBC Knowledge Park, Karnataka High Court is very clear. In case of 153C cases, if no incriminating materials are found and the assessment is already completed, it can't be again done. 153A notice, 153A read with 153C cannot be. Whether penalty under 270A will be levied, or since it's a search case, all are covered, whether 271AAB will come in. This is again the computation. The reproduction of sections as is. It's an arithmetic lesson just to understand how the underreporting works. It's a loss of 100. 143 1A makes it 90. 143 makes it loss of 40. 147 makes it positive 20. This is how practically it's going to happen for each of the assessment. Just because you declare a loss of 100, you will not accumulate it. It's going to be reduced like this. What is underreported income for 143? 40, which was under 143, and 90, which was under 143.1. 50 is underreported income. What is the tax payable? 15, whatever. For 147, 20. What is this? Income positive and determined at 20. And 40, which is and 143, difference between that, 60 will be the 30% of that. In case of underreporting, 50% of this, 50% of the tax is the penalty. And if that case is falling under misreporting, we will end up paying 200% of it, that is 36 in the last part. But at each stage, underreporting or misreported will be calculated. At each stage, for 143 stage, there is a initial penalty being levied and whatever misreporting or underreporting, and subsequently 147 is done for that. Again, the Access Letter 147 as reduced by the Access Letter 143. The problem is, in 147 when you reopen a different footing and the additions are agreed in 143, what happens? See, that is possible. During assessment you have agreed for 50 lakh addition, paid taxes, penalty has been dropped. When it comes to 147, income is determined at say 200 lakhs. Originally you declared under 139.1 as 50 lakhs. Under 143, you voluntarily accepted it to be 100 lakhs. To pay the taxes, penalty was dropped. Under 147, for various reasons that you open, the income becomes 200. So we limit the penalty whether on 200 minus 100 or 200 minus 50. Which means in the first 50 they are letting you off. Guarantee. Because assessed under 143, at that stage if they let you go is one stage. Otherwise, in the first stage you would have paid tax penalty on 100 minus 50. As it may be 50% of that or 200% depending on how you have agreed upon. Next, 200 minus 100. Because the second stage there is again addition paid. If it is misreporting, on the 100, 30% tax, on that 200% if you are again falling under misreporting then. Under two stages. In the first stage, it can be underreporting. When you have agreed and some additions have been made in penalty level, it can be a case of underreporting of income and 50% by debit charge. On the second aspect of it, under reassessment, there is a possibility for the same character to be changed. For what 50 you agreed, saying because 50 for specific reason you agreed it to be 100, even if the same reason becomes 200, department may say it is misreporting. Though it was underreporting in the first instance and 50 rupees was added, there is a possibility that the same, the extension of that 100 to 200 may result in penalty under 200%. Write up of 270A. One of the objectives was that penalty for under reporting by individual is proposed to be based on tax over 30% of such under reporting, because this would lead to a higher outflow in the case of individual HF. If somebody is a 10 or 20% bracket, further the penalty outflow is more. Because 30% of under-reported income, not on assessed, if the addition made is 50 lakhs, or say we take a small example of 3 lakhs, the overall income. On the 3 lakhs, tax will be calculated and at 30%, on that 30%, 50% is under-reporting. But for some individual who in the normal course would have been a 10%, the penalty also would have been in that 100% of tax what we have awaited would have been. You save bracket, because say you had income of 1.5 lakhs, you made it 3.5 lakhs. Now ultimately we need that slab of 10%. Now the addition of 2 lakhs will be 2 lakhs into 30%, 60,000 into 50%. So the outflow for individuals and HUF for lower bracket is going to increase. For penalty on misreporting. So, reasonable cause what was existing for 271(1)(c) on both counts now is no longer applicable for misreporting. And how do they give immunity? Pay tax within 30% and does not file the appeal. And only AO can grant you immunity after expiry of credit profiling the appeal. So the commissioner's power to the discretionary power with the commissioner for dropping the penalty is now removed. AO becomes the supreme authority for penalty also. So these are other general amendment which was in run, but we will take 5 minutes questions so that we can finish off. questions on 271, 270A and its operations? Any specific issues that need to be addressed with respect to 270A? By and large, the question is new. Unless the notices start coming in and the assessments begin on that, the quantum of deliberations will only be theoretical. We are only debating, say, what happens if the office issues a notice like this? Possible that the some sort of amendment or circular notification may come in, or guidelines will be issued to the officers during the course of assessment as to how to construe a particular thing. But as of today, the law under 270A is there. It should be applicable from 1/4/2017. With respect to waiver of penalty, for 270A, it has to be passed within 12 months from the end of the month the application is received by the principal commissioner or the commissioner. And there is a sunset clause within 31st May 2017 if the application is pending as on 1/6/2016. In that 12 month period, they have to dispose of it for whether to waive penalty or not. Again, this is for granting of immunity. If penalty proceedings have been initiated and the SSC has applied for settlement and settlement proceedings have been abated at 245HA, then 273AA gives power to the principal commissioner to grant immunity from penalty, and principles of natural justice are inbuilt. Opportunity of being heard needs to be given to the SSC. 273B, all the new sections of penalty have been included there. But if you look at amendment 279, prosecution shall not, proceeding shall not be proceeded against a person for 276C or 277, in respect of whom 270A penalty has been reduced or waived as per 273A. This is a case, we will take a classic case now, it is previous defaults. You have paid the interest under 234E, debt filing fees, etc. Penalty has been dropped under 221 and thereof, but still prosecution notices are being issued and prosecutions are being launched. Say there was a failure to deposit TDS within time. It is subsequently made good by paying interest, and department felt there was a reasonable cause for not levying penalty. Even then, sanction has been accorded for prosecution. For 270A, now that is with TDS. TDS is not covered in 270A, it's only with respect to income. But if AO has given waiver from reduce the penalty, AO is 5 minutes, it's absolute. If there is a reduction in the penalty from say 100 rupees to 60 rupees, now at least for the limited purpose, prosecution cannot be launching. There was still misreporting or underreporting, and there was that addition. Only that's the benefit. Thank you for a very patient hearing.
Hello members, I still remember the day when Finance Minister made a statement that no more retrospective amendments from this government. This statement was made on the backdrop of a lot of retrospective amendments in the Finance Act 2012, which mainly haunted foreign taxpayers. But looking at 115 BBE and the second amendment to Income Tax, Finance Act 2016, looks like this legal tackle, this tax tackle is getting even more worse. And only subject matter experts like CA Prashanth G S can help the honest taxpayers come out of this tangle unscratched. So I on behalf of CA Institute acknowledge the presence of Prashanth sir for his time and efforts. Let's put our hands together. With this, we conclude the study session.